and I'm here to talk about what I call augmented legality, which is what happens when this visionary, idealized world of augmented reality that we've been discussing meets the messy and often litigious society that we live in. Now, you may be thinking, well, what types of law does AR relate to? Well, it's actually harder than you might think to boil down the legal subjects that AR touches. And we spend all day here talking about the number of different industries and areas of life, walks of life that AR is going to touch. So, consequently, the fields of law that AR is involved in will be just as broad. So, but I have 20 minutes, so I've narrowed them down to four topics. So the first, and I think the most obvious topic to talk about is that of copyright. How many here are familiar with the book's Demon and Freedom by Daniel Suarez? But one of the heroes of that book is a man named Roy Merritt, a federal agent who gains notoriety by achieving acts of heroism inside this building that's burning down and falling around. He gains the nickname the Burning Man. But at a certain point in the book, there's a statue built for Roy. And to the naked eye, it looks just like this. The average iron statue looks like any other statue you might find. But viewed through an AR device, it becomes something completely different. The statue is now wreathed in flame. There are banners hanging overhead. You can click in virtual space to activate YouTube videos and other user-generated content. Now, sculptural works, or what they're called in copyright law, those are copyrightable works. Have the creators of this augmented content created a derivative work of that statue that the owner of the statue copyright can now take action against? My personal opinion is no. I think the digital data and the statue are two different works, but again, that's a question that hasn't been answered yet. You may have seen this YouTube video from earlier in the year, a man who got a tattoo of an AR marker on his arm so that this Nintendo 3DS character can be viewed as an animated three-dimensional character on his arm every time you look at it for the appropriate device. Now, that particular piece of video was licensed to be viewed in a particular format. Now, it can be viewed anywhere this guy is through any device that is able to see it. Is that a performance that exceeds the scope of the license for whoever is providing that content? In the film industry, we have what's called sync licenses, which allow you to sync a particular piece of copyrighted music to a particular piece of film. Well, we see AR sync licenses that allow us to perform augmented content in certain designated contexts. Bottom line when it comes to copyright, identify the sources of your code and your other creative works and know who owns them. If it's not you, make sure you have the rights to it. My second topic is probably just as obvious, but you may not realize the importance of, and that's the subject of patents. The fear is that Apple's going to come in as a behemoth and swallow up the field through its patent applications. Well, that's a bit overstated. Yes, they have some patent applications, but yes, there's still a lot of room for innovation. But the other answer to that fear is that, you know, Apple's not the only one doing it, and they weren't the first either. Well, those tattoos I mentioned a few minutes ago. Well, here's an excerpt from a real patent application seeking to patent a method for using those tattoos for a means of advertising. The same patent would do the same thing for helmets in football games. If you haven't seen those, have you seen these? In the NASCAR tennis field using other augmented content. If not, have you seen any of these? Again, all excerpts from real patent applications seeking to slice off a piece of the patent pie. Now, other people are doing it, so the bottom line here when it comes to patents is this. Talk to a patent lawyer. If your business model relies at all on an innovative method of using augmented content, you owe it to yourself and to your investors, or the investors that you hope to attract, to secure this patent protection up front. That's even more important as of 3 weeks ago when the president signed the latest patent reform act, which transforms the American system from a first to invent system to a first to file system, meaning that now you can be the first person to invent something, but if somebody else comes along after you and invents it after you've done it, but beats you to the patent office and files an application first, guess who gets the patent priority rights? They do. So timing is important. My third subject is perhaps not as obvious. That's the subject of negligence, or in other words, what happens when people hurt themselves using your augmented content. Anytime that we're holding up a device to see something in front of us while we're driving, possibly a distraction is there. What about distracted walking? Will augmenting while walking become a legal issue? Well, legislators are already passing laws right now against this very thing, which is using mobile devices while walking down a city street or crossing a road. Now you add augmented content to that mix, and you can be sure that you're going to get some legislative attention, and you're going to get people with some outcry against that, and the distraction that comes with it. Now, the problem becomes even more acute when you're talking about applications, gaming applications that are directing users' paths. For example, an augmented scavenger hunt or something. And this is a subject that I would get blogged about, and I talked about a case from Washington where a restaurant sponsored a scavenger hunt within their building, and one of the players, looking for clues, went into the bathroom, slipped on a wet floor, and sued. And guess what? They won. Now, that might seem silly, but the court focused on the gaming aspect here. He said that, yeah, normally you walk into a bathroom, you should look around and realize that the floor is wet, but the owner had created this mentality, this gaming mentality in the user's mind that I need to run around faster than everybody else looking for clues. And so that took their attention off their physical surroundings and consequently heightened the owner's responsibility to warn players of that danger. Now, take that concept and export it into the augmented gaming field. Now, these are excerpts from a YouTube video called The Witness. Now, again, I don't know anything about this program, this game, other than what I've seen on YouTube. I'm sure in real life there are more safety considerations involved, and it's not quite as dangerous as it might look on YouTube. But this particular trailer views like it was directed by a person with injury. They have different pre-designated locations, hunting under tables and abandoned offices with QR codes that can give them clues, even running down rickety stairs and running into marking guard dogs. Now again, I'm sure this was sexed up for YouTube purposes, but it's an unintentional, perfect example of what can go wrong in augmented gaming. So bottom line when it comes to negligence, put yourself in your user's shoes. Know where they're going to the extent that you can. Know their physical surroundings and give the appropriate warnings. Get legal counsel on what it is you need to tell them in order to avoid liability. My final topic is that of privacy. Now, this is another hot topic buzzword we read a lot about in the news, but it's confusing to read about because there's no real one source of this law. Now, this is a word that means something entirely different depending on what country you're in. If you're in Europe, the idea of privacy is a lot different. Personal data is presumptively personal, and you have to opt into programs that use that data. That's why Google and other companies launching things like Street View have run into problems in Europe where they don't in the United States. In the U.S., we look at the subject of privacy and the sharing of information as a concept through the lens of the First Amendment. So when we have privacy laws in the United States, first of all, the common laws toward of invasion of privacy, you have to do something pretty extreme, like the stereotypical example of setting up a camera in a secret camera in a changing room. You have to invade personal privacy to that level to have committed the tort of invasion of privacy. Otherwise, we have a patchwork quilt of statutes that are passed in response to a particular constituency or a particular outcry. So, for example, you have HIPAA that protects medical records. You have the law COPA, which protects the collection or prohibits the collection of information of children younger than 13 online. You have certain financial security laws that prevent you from doing certain things with social security numbers, that kind of thing. But it's a hodgepodge, and the only way that they get passed is that a particular subject matter gets enough public attention that it gets legislative attention. Right now, for example, there are half a dozen laws pending in Congress about such things as geolocational privacy, the use of cookies online, things that we read about in headlines all the time that people make a lot of fuss over but actually aren't legal. So how does this play into the augmented space? The Federal Trade Commission recently announced its first enforcement action against a mobile app designer for violating COPA, a mobile app that was designed for children that collected too much information without parental consent, that got them in hot water legally. So social media is another vector by which AR is going to tread on people. people's privacy, or at least raise the hackles of the privacy invasion. We see here personal data being collected from public sources or from social media sources and superimposed on people's houses. Now, that is entirely legal. That's the beauty of AR, right? That's what makes AR AR, is that you can pull information, digital information, from disparate sources and put it in a visible sense, in a particular physical location that makes sense. But that's also something that's going to raise the public creepiness factor. Now, we already have, I've had on my own phone the AR app, sex offender tracker, right? It can pull that information, and you can hold it up and you can see over certain locations where a sex offender, registered sex offender, lives. Here we have an example of that hovering over their heads. At what point does that become just too invasive? You know, at what point does, and I don't know if there's a sex offender lobby, but at what point do people on this list just stand up and say, you know, enough is enough. The guy can't walk down the street without everybody knowing he's a sex offender. We need to pass a law against this. The whole registry exists in the first place because of the law. We need to limit how this data is used. That's the kind of feedback we're getting. Again, you see the woman in red here, slutty ex-girlfriend, because somebody on the user social network tagged her as such. I mean, at what point will legislatures step in and put barriers between us and what we can augment? And then, of course, the criminals can use the same thing for their own purposes. And if they're using our apps to create these criminal darknets, at what point will law enforcement step in and not only take action against them, but come to you and say, give me a back door into your apps and let me crack into these nets and see what people are putting together? And finally, there's always a segment of the population for whom any new technology is just a new way to see people naked in new and creative ways. You know, I mentioned at the outset of this subject the idea of putting up a secret camera in the changing room. And what can AR allow us to do exactly that? Well, this obviously is something that doesn't exist, and you probably saw this on YouTube last year when it came out in a fake app called Nuded. Now, the production values on this are really good. You know, somebody who wasn't paying attention would be forgiven for thinking this was a real app. But it's not. It's a spoof. It purports to let you see through people's clothes, but it's actually a spoof. And the site that posted the video said it was a spoof. Nevertheless, they got 500,000 views in the first month that this video was up. I mean, who among us wouldn't kill for that many views for our product launch? And daily requests from people who just didn't get the joke and wanted to download the app. They wanted to use this. Again, because this demand is always going to be out there, there's always going to be a segment of the population who wants this and a segment of the industry who will profit off of this. You can bet that once it becomes feasible, it will happen. Do we who provide those solutions have legal issues? So the bottom line here, CYA. Know the applicable Privacy Act laws. Know the applicable privacy rules. Think ahead about how people are using this and do some research, do your homework, know what the privacy rules are, and be prepared for backlash, even when what you're doing is legal, but again, it pushes people towards that uncomfortable convergence of data and physical experience. Now, thank you.